people coming in as we begin. Apparently there are two events going on in this building today, and there's some sort of a backlog downstairs in the lobby. Those of you who were able to make it here by 10, and of course we are also live streaming this event, so there are people who are viewing remotely, and we want to get started for all of you who are here. This is an incredibly important event hosted in the last year, examining one of the big existential questions that guides not only conversation around this year's political election, but really kind of why organizations like EPI exist. And it's examining the role of government. And there is a group only a few months in its publication, which is examining this question, you know, not just philosophically, but using available evidence and drawing reasonable conclusions. And I'll sort of get into why this is especially important and relevant to the work that we do here at EPI. The panel of people who are going to be speaking to you this afternoon, this morning, four of them are authors of said book, How Big Should Government Be? And we do have some copies of it that will be available for sale. I understand that the price that we're able to offer these at, it's $20, which is cheaper than what you can get at any work for you. The authors of the book are Jeff Madrick, Lane Kenworthy, Jon Bakija, and Peter Lindert. Jeff Madrick is the director of the Bernard Schwartz Rediscovering Government Initiative at the Century Foundation, and he is also the editor. Then we have Lane Kenworthy, who is professor of sociology and the Yankovich Chair in Social Thought at the University of California in San Diego. Jon Bakija is a professor of economics, a distinguished professor of economics at Williams College in Williamstown, Massachusetts, and has been the author of several books, mostly looking at the role of taxes and tax policy. And then we have economic historian Peter Lindert, who is the distinguished research professor of economics at the University of California, Davis, and a research associate at the National Bureau for Economics, who are going to speak and present their book, and then will be followed by two opinion and public thought researchers who will examine this within the context of real people and how real people think about issues. Celinda Lake, who is president of Lake Research Partners. Celinda has been generous enough to join us at many EPI events, and she's also one of the Democratic Party's leading political strategists and serves as a tactician and advisor to various an opinion expert on several issue areas, among which are the economy, healthcare, education, and healthcare, education, and the environment. And then we also have John Halpin, who is a senior fellow at the Center for Economic Progress. He also focuses, and John is also the author of a year-long study, very apropos for today's conversation, on the trust and confidence that people have in the federal government. I am not going to take too much thunder away from the but in it, they do a great job of looking at this role, not just in the way that most people do, just kind of talking about big government, small government, but really trying to narrow the focus and look at available evidence. They identify four deficiencies that sort of that we have an economy that's, or a public policy that's investing too little in infrastructure, and they don't just use that as a buzzword. They unpack that for why it's truly important, identifying that infrastructure, investments in infrastructure, creates growth, innovation, competitiveness, continuity in the economy, and also economic vibrancy. Not to mention that it's a steady supply of good jobs, where if those investments occur during market downturns, you can keep people at higher living standards. So insecurity is a key deficiency of current conditions. Looking at too many people who are an economic shock away from utter despair and an inability to have basic, consistent living standards. Of an ability for someone who was born into a low-income household to have a reasonable thought of an opportunity of moving into an upper rung. And then they look at inequality, what growth we do have and how it's distributed, and seeing that a disproportionate share is, of course. After identifying those four deficiencies in our current system, they kind of examine whether or not it's the market or public investments that should drive remediating them. They, of course, examine the market's inability to deal with these issues and make the case for the types of programs and policies from the public sector which can make a by opining about policies that exist in the United States, but also looking at what's done around the world. They also examine the question of whether or not we can afford it and what that would look like in terms of its impact on spending and economic growth. A provocative book by its subject matter, but incredibly well-reasoned. And you know, one of the great contributions I think you all make is taking this debate beyond just something that people argue about, but giving us a frame. And whereas most people want to solve this determinatively, they acknowledge that maybe the standard that we can prove whether or not it's government beyond all reasonable doubt, but where we have a preponderance of the evidence that government can be a part of the solution. So after the authors present, we are going to hear from our opinion researchers who are really going to, because we can have all of the theoretical discussions we want. It's how do you have this conversation, not just in the House and Senate chambers, but also in living and family rooms across the country, houses of worship, civic institutions. What's going to resonate? What's going to impact people's in this conversation? So that's what you have before you. We are going to begin our conversation with one of the authors, Jeff Madrick. And Jeff, if you could just turn on that microphone there, we'll be ready to go.
There we go. I've never been good at paying attention until the interruption. Thank you for the Economic Policy Institute for setting this up for us in their lovely new headquarters. I still smell the fresh paint. Thank you to my colleagues for going out of their way to come and make this presentation. This book, I think, is quite an important book, but let me tell you specifically what this book is about. This book is about how America has constrained itself from doing what has to be done for social justice and the future prosperity, a view that government, by and large, should be small. At best, it should be limited. That attitude, small is beautiful, has infested us. I use argumentative word, but I think it's true, at least since the Reagan years. And it is not supported by the evidence. That's what this book is about. This book is about the evidence. Why do we believe in small government? That there's the American national character, probably built on a distrust of government. There is the attitude that social policies almost invariably create dependencies. That's always partially, it's a very small part of the issue. Social policies, by and large, help people. I can go on with some of the reasons, but that we maintain this point of view. What I want to emphasize, and what I think everyone up here will emphasize, is how damaging that space, inequality, stagnating wages, opportunity, educational equality from K through 12, an issue that's not talked about enough, talked about but not enough. The horrid infrastructure. I live in New York City. I was just talking about trying to make my way. LaGuardia Airport, as you know, is a nightmare. And those are just our examples in New York City of what's going on. And in case anybody hasn't noticed, there's a climate problem. We're going to talk about the evidence. The evidence is statistical. It's cross-country evidence. Let me review only very quickly that the role of government in American history. One of the great myths that has contributed to this idea that government should be small in America is that the 1800s used to be laissez-faire. Milton Friedman said, Manifesto, Capitalism and Freedom, which really laid out almost every argument from the conservative point of view. The truth is we never had any truly laissez-faire government in America. You know the story of Jefferson buying the Louisiana territories. We know the stories about Alexander Hamilton and policy, that is loans to business, and a central bank. That's not laissez-faire. There were scores of regulations, even in the colonial period, regulations concerning product regulation. There were scores of regulations government that set up how land should be distributed and paid for. A principle of Jefferson's, by the way, that I think often gets overlooked. Then, of course, the federal government, under some of the mythology of big government, backed away from serious so-called public improvements, but the states stepped in. But most important, I believe, the states built the education system. We were leaders, I get some of this from Peter Lindert's book, Growing Public, 2004. We were leaders in the development of primary education, free primary education. Even always free in Massachusetts. For a while, there was a tuition payment. Massachusetts made the radical move to eliminate what amounted to tuition and have free public education paid for by property taxes. It was a distribution of income program before the Civil War, well before the Germany, France, and England on education per child, and indeed even more. Big issue. Laissez-faire government? Are you kidding me? In the 1800s? But here, then we of course had the technological universities. We invested in them. We gave them at Berkeley, MIT, Ohio State, and so forth. One important issue in the late 1800s, very often ignored, was both sanitation. New York City was very early in running water and sanitizing its water. This allowed for the development of cities without disease, without serious disease. The development of cities was a source of economic growth in America, often ignored, I think, by mainstream economists. Interesting and imperative by the work of Jane Jacobs. I think economists have picked up on that. Sanitation, built by GE, not built by Standard Oil, built by government sanitation systems, were what allowed cities to develop and become a major source of growth. Then we had high schools. Women went to high school. Then we had research developed by the government, even very early in the 1900s, in fact. And on the story goes. No such thing as laissez-faire government. We started the income tax in the early 1900s. It grew in size, and the economy kept growing at a rapid rate. One way of looking at it is the economy, the growing government wasn't an impediment. Another way of looking at it is the government programs were actually fostered economic growth in that period. And I think we can make a strong case for that. My point to present in. I'm pretty excited about it and hope this catches on. The main point, however, is historical evidence suggests the importance of the government role. Now we're going to turn to statistical evidence, cross-country evidence, and evidence about what we need and neglect in this country as a consequence of our act. I'm not saying and let me make one last point that is close to me, and I hope it gets picked up more often. Government is an agent of change. And by thinking government is small, you are suppressing change. Nobody in the certainly few people thought government would have to build all the darn high schools in the country. They didn't think that was going to be a role in government. Surely they didn't think government was going to have to subsidize college sometime down the road. Time and again, we are not able to change. We learn a lot more. We know that young kids need education. That's new knowledge. We need government to make that happen. I'm going to stop there, but I want to make this point clear. Government as an agent of change, clearly businesses also. But times change, knowledge changes, needs change, probably has to get bigger to deal with all this. So let me pass this on to my colleagues, Christian and all. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. And while we make sure we can do this to our satisfaction. Tech help? Yeah, it's not working.
F5's not working. What's the one at the bottom?
I'm beginning.
There we go.
Wow. And I think this means forward. It does. Okay. Thank you. Picking up on the history theme that Jeff has already opened for us, let's go back to the 1960s, early 1960s, at the time when Milton Friedman wrote Capitalism and Freedom. His kind of conservative challenge against big government was socially responsible. It should be, even in retrospect, very welcome. Because at that time, they had reasonable theories about how government could be bad. That was their chosen slant. But at the same time, we didn't have a whole lot of evidence. So they laid down a very good set of issues before us. We should note that they didn't doubt big government of all kinds. I'd never in the works of Milton and Rose Friedman have I ever found any critique of big military spending. That was left to I.F. Stone and others. And by the way, I should have added Dwight David Eisenhower and his famous 1960 speech about the military-industrial complex. But their complaint about social programs and the like really does deserve its day in court. We didn't have the data back then. Good news since then. It takes a long time. 70 is indeed a long time. You can gather the information, you can see the actual history, you can run the tests, and hopefully sell the results. Okay, accumulating, and that's very good news. They've been accumulating thanks to the computer revolution, the rise of government data supply. All kinds within our country and internationally by the OECD. And then with the rise of randomized control trials, I want to remind folks or have alert them to read about the negative income tax experiments circa 1970 operated out of University of Wisconsin. And those experiments, pretty good as randomized tests. Some glitches in the selection issues, and there was, of course, political debate, but they did show you overall, when the smoke is cleared, that if you have basic income supports for people in time of need, this is not reducing labor supply, it is not breaking up families. Okay, now, however, in response to the new arrival of evidence, the conservative response has been to bluff. They have been bluffing since 1970. That is the best way to say it. The critique of large government has tipped away from watching the facts and being more ideological with less interest in confronting that evidence. If you look at that literature, there's almost no econometrics, statistical, of the today's standard. There's no study of history. And even the most responsible conservatives, I often applaud Martin Feldstein's work, but he always retreated into theory and simulations. Really, when you read the tax code and you accept my model, this should be bad for incentives. But that's as far as it goes. It's not factual. Okay, so what happened was the idea of let's find out about the facts has gotten replaced by, hey, we knew all along. And only the liberals have just not taken wisdom on this yet. Remember some of the steps in this kind of reasoning? The Laffer curve of 1971 or so, long gone, flunked every empirical test. We are not in that amazing range of the Laffer curve. The sneering about welfare queens, Charles Murray's fables in Losing Ground. Rush Limbaugh discovered a whole new industry, and it's gone on since then. Sad. These bluffs do need to be called. Okay. Now, here's some of the lessons that you get from this growing history and from the increasing sophistication of the tests available to us. Here it comes. There is, as I've said before, from history and econometrics, you get a free lunch result. That is to say, countries with zero cost in terms of their gross domestic product, in that sense, a free lunch for the aggregate of the country. They get many things. Here's a list of them to speak at the international level at the moment. They have lower poverty rates than, say, we, lower inequality, they live longer. They have cleaner government. By the way, corruption was always supposed to be one of the dangers of big government, etc. The largest social spending governments of the world, centered in Northern Europe, are always ranked the cleanest, least corrupt government when you have interviews of multinational corporations. The United States is not that high, but okay. And in addition to all those good things, they don't have any bigger budget deficits. It's not true. And to quickly put in an intra-U.S. note, a state like California, huge spender on social programs, a huge regulator, running a surplus. And when you ask people how happy they are, they seem to be happier than the grumpy Americans and others. Okay, how is that possible? How could that happen? Well, three really quick reasons. I want to keep all of these, my comments, as short as I can to help others. Okay, first of all, all the theories about how bad this could be, they assume that government is stupid or that it's just somehow in control of people with the most incredibly bad influences. In democracies, that's a strange assumption. And the fact is, these governments have never adopted the silly kind of anti-growth thing that you model. Basically, oh, here, I'll find somebody productive, suck everything from them, and give it to you who want to strum your guitar on the street for the rest of your life now that you're leaving school. Those are fables, and they all assume something. They assume that all government spending is either just transferred into the pockets of somebody else, or even worse, it's actually wasted. It's spent on whatever, you know, poison Skittles, whatever you want. And it doesn't actually work that way. It never has. And a second big reason, see the language here. Social benefit programs, the controversial part of government, are less bureaucratic and less costly to administer than the private alternatives. Here are four quick examples. Universal health insurance is less bureaucratic than voluntary private health insurance. They spend less through a public health insurance program to provide the services than the private, usually employer-based programs spend to keep you from getting coverage or the benefits. Big broad taxes cost much less to administer than selective taxes and tax gimmicks and tax breaks like we have a lot of here. Big universal pension programs like Social Security cost way less, 1% or less is the administrative cost of in their budgets, than in privatized systems like Chile or Thatcher's UK, where these things will take up 15% of the total amount of the pensions just into the fees for the insurance companies. Okay, income safety nets are less costly to administer than private charity, and the book documents that at one point too. Okay, final quick reason. There could have been a longer list, but 10 minutes. So the welfare states invest more in mother's career and in newborn's development. And that's always true, and it's still true despite the kind of tiny program being offered by the Trump family. Among rich countries, the U.S. is last in providing parental leave and public care, public infant care. And this should be a no-brainer. There's some empirical evidence in favor of it that is cited in the fuller version of this. But it should have been a no-brainer. Look, if you have the general public helping people get parental leave for a while, you're creating more human capital both in child and in caregiving parent. Okay, the final quick reality checks to remind you of, and Jon Bakija's talk is going to get onto this kind of theme too, I think, even larger. If big government's bad for growth, then within the U.S., why don't you see just spiraling into poverty on behalf of California, Connecticut, and Maryland, and Mississippi and Oklahoma rise to prosperity? In world history, why are all the welfare states recent? They're since 1960. And why are they rich? Okay, thank you. Here you go. And then we have to switch, so.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to look at evidence on the question of whether a bigger government would hurt the U.S. economy. Now, most of what I'm going to do is show you some pictures and facts that corroborate a lot of what Peter Lindert was just saying. Let me start by talking a little bit about the theory of this. So the theory for why a bigger government might hurt the economy is simply that higher taxes are going to reduce the incentive to do economically productive things, and to the extent that people respond to those incentives, for example, by working less, that's going to have some cost in terms of economic prosperity. On the other hand, certainly government spending on things like education and infrastructure and basic scientific research should have positive effects on economic prosperity. Before looking at the evidence, let me also say that if we were to find that, for example, higher taxes had a negative effect on GDP, that wouldn't settle the debate, obviously, because government provides lots of benefits that are not measured in GDP, including producing greater equality, equality of opportunity, protection of rights, but are very valuable. Okay? So my basic theme is that you have to torture the data very hard to get it to confess to a big negative effect of taxes on economic growth along those lines. So on this chart, on the left-hand side is showing over the long run of U.S. history, since 1870, some various indicators of taxes. So the blue line is federal tax revenues as a percentage of GDP. The red line is total general government tax revenues as a percentage of GDP. The green line is the corporate statutory tax rate. The black line is the top marginal tax rate in the personal income tax. And you can see all of these things have experienced huge changes over time that were very persistent. So very large changes in taxes over time. Taxes were much lower in the late 1800s and early 1900s than they are today. Top marginal tax rates went way up and they came back down. The right-hand side graphs out the log of real GDP per person in the U.S. between 1870 and 2014. And the benefit of showing it in log form is that the slope of the line is the growth rate. So if we just had a constant growth rate over time, this would just be a perfectly straight upward sloping line. And what the red dashed line is the trend from 1870 to 2014. And if you look at the long run of U.S. history, it's very, very hard to reject the hypothesis that we just have a constant long run growth rate that we always return to. And this is important because how could it be that these enormous and persistent changes in taxes are having big negative effects on the growth rate if the long-run growth rate is never changing in U.S. history. So right off the bat, the idea that taxes on net are very harmful to economic growth, once you take into account also the government spending they're financing, kind of fails the sniff test when you look at what's happening on the right-hand side of this graph. Now, that same picture is very similar in other rich countries. So I'll just show, I have data going back to the 1800s for 12 rich countries. And basically, what this graph is showing is the gray dots are the size of government spending as a percentage of GDP, and it's much bigger in the second half of this 1870 to 2013 period that the graphs are showing. It's much bigger in the second half than in the first half. So the size of government relative to the size of the economy grew dramatically in all rich countries. The dashed line is showing the predicted trend in log GDP per person that you would predict based on what the trend was from 1870 through the beginning of the Great Depression in 1929. And the black line is the actual log GDP per person in that country. And what this shows is that for all these countries that experience a huge growth in the size of government, in the second half of the period when government was much bigger, GDP per person rose above its historical trend or stayed right on it. There's no evidence that countries that raised the size of government had GDP per person drop below its historical trend. Okay, so very inconsistent with the idea that large increase in government is hurting growth. If anything, for some of these countries, growth seems to be picking up at least for a while, and then they seem to return to their long-run trend. You can see that for another six countries here. So the last graph is for the United States, and you can see the 1870 to 1929 trend almost perfectly predicts today's log of GDP per person, despite the fact that government got much, much bigger. Okay, we could also look whether over the last 100 years, did countries that had larger increases in the size of government experience any loss of economic growth as a result. So what this graph shows is on the horizontal axis, it shows the change in the size of government as a percentage of GDP. And there's a lot of variation from like 20% for Australia to 45% for Sweden. And then, and this is over the last 100 years. And on the vertical axis, it shows the growth rate, the annual percentage growth rate in real GDP per person. And what you can see is there's not any strong correlation here. If anything, there's an upward sloping relationship. The countries that had bigger increases in the size of government also had slightly faster growth rates. If you control for the initial incomes of these countries to allow for like poorer countries to converge to rich countries, then you basically find no correlation at all. Another piece of evidence is we can get much better data if we start at 1960. So this is showing that back in 1960, the Nordic nations like Denmark, Finland, Sweden, and Norway, and I'll show those some of those on the next graph, had very similar size governments to the U.S. So government as a percentage of GDP in all in the Nordic countries in the U.S. were very similar back in 1960. Okay, since then, the Nordic nations increased the size of government dramatically by on the order of 15% of GDP. And that's what the bottom two lines in the graph are showing. So the blue line in each of these graphs is government spending, or sorry, taxes as a percentage of GDP in the US, and the red line is taxes as a percentage of GDP in the Nordic nation that we're looking at. So on the left we have Denmark, on the right we have Finland. The top two lines are showing the log of GDP per person. In the red line is the Nordic country, the blue line is the US, and you can see that basically despite this large divergence in the size of government between the Nordic nations and the US, log of GDP per person just basically follows the same path in both the US and the Nordic nations. There's no evidence that the Nordic nations started to fall behind the US as they grew their governments. And you can see something similar going on in Norway and in Sweden. Okay. Looking more generally at about 23 industrialized nations, what this graph shows is from 1960 to 2013, on the horizontal axis, it's showing how much did taxes go up as a percentage of GDP since the early 1960s. And on the vertical axis, it's showing the average growth rate in real GDP per person since 1960. And there's basically no evidence that the countries that increased the size of government more and taxes more experienced any decline in their growth rates relative to other countries. There's also no correlation across industrialized nations between the 1960s and today, between the change in taxes as a percentage of GDP, which is shown on the horizontal axis, and the percentage change in hours worked per working age adult. So if you look over these 23 industrialized nations, there's no evidence that countries that had really big tax increases saw hours worked per adult go down more than the countries that didn't raise taxes so much. And that's partly explained by some of the things Peter Lindert is talking about, which is like countries like, for example, the Nordic countries have done a really good job of fostering female labor force participation by making it a lot easier to stay attached to the labor force when you have children. So there's government subsidized and provided childcare and preschool and lots of paid family leave so that you don't have to lose your job when you have a child and so forth. So these countries have the highest female labor force participation in the world, and that partly compensates for whatever effect taxes might have been having. So the last thing I want to say is, it's not true that conservatives have not done any econometric studies to support their claims that taxes are hurting growth. So like, for example, Martin Feldstein, when he wants to argue that taxes are harmful to growth, he looks at the following correlation. He shows, so the left-hand side graph here is showing that what happened to the marginal tax rates on people at the top of the income distribution. So the top gray line there is the top marginal tax rate in the income tax. The thick black line is the tax rate on people in the top 0.1 of the income distribution. And then the bottom two lines are for people lower down in the top 10% of the income distribution. And what this shows is since 1960, we've cut taxes on the rich tremendously. And what Martin Feldstein would point to is, well, if you look at the right-hand side graph, the incomes of the rich before taxes went up tremendously. And Feldstein would say, this is a response to incentives. Look, taxes are really harmful. When you have high taxes on the rich, they don't earn so much income. When you cut taxes, they earn more income. The problem with that claim is there's so many other things going on that can explain the rising inequality that we see on the right-hand side of the graph, including globalization, skill bias, technical change. Things like when you cut the top tax rate in the personal income tax, money comes out of the corporate tax base and goes into the personal tax base, and all this data on inequality is measuring income on personal tax returns. So there's lots of alternative explanations besides the rich are working harder for this relationship. We do see across countries, and what this graph shows is countries that had bigger cuts in tax rates on the rich since the 1960s had bigger increases in the share of income going to the top 1% of the income distribution, which is consistent with what we saw in the last graph. However, if we look at the same graph, except now looking at economic growth, we see the countries that had bigger cuts in tax rates on the rich, measured on the horizontal axis, did not have faster economic growth overall in GDP. And what that suggests is, to the extent that taxes are causing what we saw in the previous graph, that tax cuts led to rising incomes for the rich, it's not an increase in productive economic activity. So it could be things like an increase in rent seeking. So for example, corporate executives bargaining harder for higher pay. Or it could partly also reflect changes in tax avoidance. Maybe there's less incentive to avoid and evade taxes when we have lower tax rates. Which won't change GDP, but it will change reported incomes in these graphs, and also shifting of income between the corporate and personal tax bases, which is clearly playing some role here. So I think the bottom line is, again, you really have to torture this data pretty hard to get it to tell a story that taxes are really having big negative effects on economic prosperity. Thank you.
And watch your step.
Fine.
Okay, great, thanks. I'm going to say, I'm going to make 3 points here. The bulk of this book, which is Peter and John's chapters, is about the effects or lack thereof of government size on economic growth rates in the United States and across these countries. So Peter focuses on size in terms of government revenues, a share of GDP, or expenditures. But there are other arguments, and the punchline, I assume you have already gotten, is that there's no strong indication of any sort of harm to economic growth coming from a larger government, either in terms of its social policy or overall. At the level that exists over this period of the last 100 years or so, it doesn't mean there could never be an adverse effect. At some level, size of government almost certainly would begin to harm the economy, but countries don't seem to have reached that level, as best we can tell from the real-world experience. A bigger government in the United States. And Peter deals a little bit with the first of these that I'm going to talk about, but I just want to say a little more about three of them. So one is that government programs don't really work. Peter talks a little bit about this in his chapter remarks today, and Jeff and I, in the first chapter in the book, cover this to some extent, too. We focus on four areas where government could help in the United States these days, and where we haven't been doing nearly as well as we should since the late 1970s. So one is another is equality of opportunity, and then the last is shared prosperity. And so I want to say just a few things about each of these. I'm not really going to say anything about infrastructure. I think the case for government helping there is quite obvious. If the private sector were going to solve this problem, it would be doing it. The difficulty we face over the last generation is not that we've been spending a lot of money and it's been all on boondoggles, it's that we haven't been making the investments. The argument there, or the conclusion, is fairly straightforward. We also have a very solid base of evidence that suggests that more government is good at reducing economic insecurity. If we think about economic insecurity as consisting mainly of not having enough income or enough resources to secure a decent standard of living, and then also having a reasonable amount of financial stability experience over time, mainly since the 1930s when we began to put government programs into place, but also looking across these rich democratic nations. So this first graph that I have up here shows a useful measure of, you might call it, or public insurance programs along the horizontal axis. It's just share of GDP with a little bit of an adjustment for the share of the population that's elderly that's going to automatically cause more money to be spent on these programs, and also the unemployment rate. And you see the usual, you know, European countries further over to the right, and the United States among a few others over to the left. On the vertical axis is a kind of better, more direct measure of poverty or low level of government surveys now increasingly will ask a battery of questions about whether, for example, you're unable to pay your rent at any point in the last 6 months, you live in a neighborhood that's dangerous but can't afford to move, whether you didn't go to see a doctor when you thought you needed to because you couldn't afford it, and so on. And those questions to calculate the share of the population that we might call experiencing material hardship or material deprivation. So higher is worse here on the vertical axis. And you see a not relationship or pattern in these data suggesting that countries with bigger welfare states, more expansive public insurance programs, tend to have less material hardship. If you prefer a more inequality-based measure or conception of economic security or insecurity, you can use what's pretty standard in Europe and in a lot of cross-country research, which is a relative poverty measure. So you set the poverty line as a certain fraction of the median income in the particular country. That's not the way our government measures poverty, but it's very common in comparing across countries. Here you see, again, a very strong relationship with countries with more expansive public insurance programs tending to have less relative poverty or less inequality in the bottom half of the income distribution. And here's a measure, same thing along the horizontal axis. On the vertical axis here is a measure of financial stability. So what this does is say, of people, of individuals in a country who experience an income loss from 1 year to the next of 20% or more of their income, so you're earning $50,000, let's say, in year one, and in the next year you're earning $40,000 or less for whatever reason. You lost your job, you were out sick, became disabled, took time off for a pregnancy or to care for an elderly relative. All sorts of things can happen. So of people who suffer or experience that kind of income decline, excuse me, earnings decline, what percentage experience a similar decline in overall household income? So you can make up for the individual earning loss by a second earner, for example, earning more, but much more commonly you do it because some public insurance program kicks in and replaces a decent fraction of the individual earnings you lost. And here again, you see the U.S. is kind of in the middle upper left there. It's right on top of Spain, so it's not easy to identify. But higher is worse here, so higher on the vertical axis means a larger fraction where an individual is experiencing a sizable earnings decline, the household income is also declining significantly. And once again, you see a very straightforward and pretty strong relationship across the countries. Okay, so that's economic insecurity, and there's more data. This is just a sampling. What about equality of opportunity or inequality of opportunity? Well, here, what we're thinking of mainly is the chances of people who grow up in less advantaged homes where the parents have lower education or lower income or the neighborhood is not so great and schools are not as good as we'd like them to be, their chances of reaching the middle class or better. And roughly speaking, in the United States these days, if you grew up in a household in the bottom 20% of the income distribution, your odds are about 30 to 40% of making it to the middle class, the middle 20% or higher. We have varying estimates depending on the data source. That's not the worst possible scenario, but it's not nearly as good as we'd like to. And as best we can tell, it's not as good as some of these other rich countries do, although there too, depending on the data source you look at, you can get slightly different results. What do we know about the contribution of government programs? Well, early education seems to be key. We've got a growing base of evidence that increasingly strongly suggests that good quality, universal, comprehensive early education available at about 12 months of age. It's fine if you do it just for those in the year prior to kindergarten, but seemingly even better if you do it earlier in the life cycle. Tends to equalize both cognitive and non-cognitive skills of kids as they enter the formal schooling system and has lasting effects throughout the life course. And it does that mainly by bringing up those at the bottom, not by pulling down those at the top. Secondly, we've got some, still very limited, but some fairly compelling evidence that simply getting more money to low-income households tends to improve the odds of kids from those households reaching the middle class or better. We've got some experimental and quasi-experimental evidence that suggests this. It's still, I'd say, a fairly thin body of evidence, but it's getting stronger. And then third, reducing the cost of college seems to help. There's a big debate here in the United States, mostly on the left, about exactly how to do that, the best way to do it, but evidence suggests that this too plays a key role in increasing the odds that those coming from less advantaged backgrounds will make it to the middle or higher. Shared prosperity, the story is twofold. So by shared prosperity, I simply mean that given an amount of economic growth, does a decent fraction of that reach ordinary Americans, those in the middle and below? And that hasn't been happening in the last generation or so. It did to a considerable extent in the period from the end of World War II up till the mid to late 1970s, but it simply hasn't since, and that's simply another way of saying that we've had growing income inequality and a lot of growth in the amount of income inequality. Can government help here? Well, it can in a variety of ways. We know from our own experience and that of other rich countries that A key part of the story in rising incomes for those in the bottom, roughly the bottom fourth of the income distribution since the late 1970s, has been government transfers, or net government transfers, if you take into account taxes that they pay. And that's not terribly surprising. There's a lot of rhetoric and discussion in the United States about how working your way out of poverty is always the best strategy, but in fact, many people who are in the lower fifth or the lower quarter either don't have jobs or are unlikely to have jobs. There's some disability, there's family considerations, there's frictional and structural unemployment at any point in time. Some of them are elderly, some of them are still in school. So there are lots of reasons to think that while more employment as a solution to poverty can certainly help, that's not been the key in most rich countries over the last generation. So the countries where there's been more sharing of prosperity to those at the bottom have been those that have raised or increased their government transfers as their economy has grown. Not even necessarily increasing the share of GDP that goes to government transfers, but simply keeping that up over time as the economy grows. For the middle class, of course, earnings are much, much more important than government programs, although government programs matter to a non-trivial degree to a more than tiny fraction of those in the middle class. But they're less important as a mechanism of ensuring shared prosperity. Here in the United States, there are a variety of things that government can do to help the middle class, and I'd be happy to talk more about it. I'm sure others on the panel could in the question and answer. The list is long, but I will say here that this is not an easy problem to solve, and that's a big part of the reason why we have a continuing very vibrant, I think, debate about exactly the right strategy or combination of strategies. Okay, two other points, and then I'll stop. There are two other arguments that are very frequently raised against a bigger role for government. One is that it doesn't harm economic growth, maybe it can do some good, but maybe there are better alternatives. And the ones that are usually offered, obviously one is smaller government with the hope that that'll increase market vitality and increase economic growth. Again, the story of this book is that we don't see evidence in favor of that at the level that exists. But other people will argue that we should rely much more on families or on intermediary organizations, voluntary associations, civil society to solve these types of problems. I think those can help, but I simply want to mention two things. One is that even at their best, neither of those solutions is comprehensive enough. It's only of a wide enough swath of the population to be as comprehensive as we'd like. And then the other point here is that both of those, families and voluntary organizations or civil society, have been weakening in the United States for the last half century or so. And nobody, to my knowledge, has come up with a compelling story about how to fix that. It would be great if we could, don't get me wrong. I would fully already existing porousness of these two proposals, and then they're weakening over time. The last thing I want to mention is the argument that we can't pay for it, that we can't afford it. And here, Peter mentioned that there's no the size of government or the size of social programs and government deficits or government debt. That's what this picture shows here. So this is government expenditures as a share of GDP across these rich nations over the course of the 21st century so far. And on the share of GDP, and you don't see the expected pattern. The countries spend more. Not all of them, but most of them tend to pay for this. Here's what things look like in the United States compared to other countries. So this is government expenditures as a share of GDP. The grayish dots are for each of these countries, again, averaged over the 21st century so far. You often hear the complaint or worry that, well, this is a nice thing to aim for, a nice story, but the United States can't possibly become anywhere close to Denmark or Sweden or Norway or any other European nation for that matter. The hollow circle here is the United States back in 1920, a century ago. What this shows you is a very simple point. We're closer today to Denmark and Sweden and Norway or whatever other country is your favorite than we are to the United States of a century ago. This is not a horribly onerous task, a terrible slog to get through. We could, if we have the will, and here I lead into our next speakers, move very much in this direction.
Thank you, Lane, and thank you also, John and Peter and Jeff. We are now going to move to a conversation that looks at what the American electorate thinks about this issue, big, also small, within the context of government policy and also within the context of, I'm sure, the political choices that they have before them this year, which must present such a wonderfully rich source of information, John. Conversation.
Thank you very much. Well, first of all, one of the things that's great, I think, about public opinion data is just as you all were mythbusters and conventional wisdom was wrong about the economy and just terrific presentations, I have to say the conventional 95% of the time, plus or minus 5%. So I think John and I are here to be mythbusters as well. I'm going to make a couple of points about myths and then a couple of points about barriers. Everybody knows that the public is against a role for government. And it is certainly true that perceptions of the role for government is the single biggest predictor of long-term political attitudes in the country right now. So if you want to know why someone is Republican or Democratic, and asking them the role of government would be the best predictor of that attitude. And the public overall splits, although it's tipping slightly more toward role of government. The perceptions on the role of government underpin the gender gap. The reason that men and women is women tend to see a partnership and a role for government. Men tend to think it's a good day when government hasn't done anything bad to you. The biggest gap in this is among college-educated men and women. So when we ask ourselves about a role for 40% of women say yes, there should be. 49% of men say yes, there should be. They still split, but they are significantly less supportive than men. Among college-educated women, 62% say there should be a role for government in the economy. 39% of college. And I would make your book is, I don't think we should subsidize men in college until they learn more when they're there. Radical idea, but just a possibility. There is a similar difference between married and single people. There is a similar difference. Women and white men differ a lot on the role for government. And in some ways, the most interesting is the millennials, and John is a real expert on this as well, are the age cohort most supportive of a role for government. So if you think about that, women, millennials, understand that the Democrats should be getting more and more in favor of a role for government, but you also understand that demographics are in our favor. The country is moving, despite all the anti-government rhetoric and despite all the distrust in government, and both of us are going to mention this in a moment, the country is moving over the next couple of decades solidly in the direction of a role for government. You would not know that if you were living in Washington, D.C. right now. The second thing, and you mentioned it, Lane, you said some very interesting points that the public is actually in a often, particularly women think, often you have to move to a government solution because it's more comprehensive, because it has enough reach, because ISIS by yourself, how are you going to take on a global economy? International corporations are now perceived to be more powerful than governments. How are you going to take on the big banks? As one wonderful woman in a focus group said about the financial FHA has your mortgage, and I didn't even know they had my mortgage. Greece makes the decision, and my pension declines. I didn't even know. I don't even like Greek food. Now, I like Greek food, but you get her point, right? These decisions are made completely out of people's control, and government is the one place powerful and be on behalf of people. You also have increased mobility. So 73% of Americans do not live in the county they were born in. Mobility had been depressed during the recession. You couldn't get out from underneath your house. You couldn't get a job dramatically in the next 10 years. It's already on the rise. And people think, I don't want to move from Wisconsin to Mississippi and have a dramatically different food safety system or water quality or education system. So as mobility increases, you also have a desire for a greater role for government. Regulation. And the great news is, much as your analysis, conventional wisdom is wrong about where the public is on both of these roles. So if you ask the public, do you want to spend tons more dollars and increase your taxes? Yeah, you can get a negative number, sure. But if you ask of education, even if it raised your taxes, 64% of the people say yes. Reduce the deficit, 62% say yes. Social Security and Medicare, 58% say yes. This is true even though over 60% of millennials don't think Social Security or Medicare will be there for them when they get there. We haven't had, and EPI has been really a great voice in this, we haven't had enough dialogue about the role that government can play in getting the economy going again. And John can speak to this in great detail. But the point of the matter is, across the board, even in realms that are perceived primarily to be local, as Jeff was saying, like of increased spending. Regulatory, everybody knows that the public doesn't want more regulation. Everybody but the public. I would really commend you to look at a study that was done by the Patricia Bauman Foundation, a great friend of all of us in this room. Many of you even supported the book, for all I know. Yes, that shows across the board, people think they are critical of regulation right now, but not because they think it's too much. It's because they don't think it's fair, that it's not applied evenly, that the big guys get out from underneath it, that they pay a small fine that they budget and charge you for, by the way, anyway. Have unsafe food, make your working conditions unsafe. Everybody knows, for example, that everybody hates OSHA, right? Actually, OSHA is one of the most popular government agencies out there, to the great surprise of OSHA. A solid majority of Americans are in favor of OSHA. You know who likes OSHA the best? Because they've moved from Wisconsin to North Carolina, and they say, guess who gets to walk in and see all this toxic shit sitting right next to my workplace? We're the ones in those jobs. We know exactly what's at stake here. So the number one thing that people would like more regulation on is actually government, which is part of the problem. And food, water, imports, prescription drugs, Wall Street, you name it. In most areas, people are massively in favor of greater regulation, fair regulation, by which they mean the big guys ought to get hit just as hard as the little guys do. So, first of all, we are not ready to be Denmark. In fact, Americans would be really nervous about being that close to Denmark. They'd want to move back. If they saw that chart, Lane, I think they'd say, well, there's the root of all of our problems. We've moved more toward Denmark. We should move back. The individual. But there's nothing contradictory about being for the individual, the power of the individual, and being for a strong role for government. In fact, as everyone has articulated here, the government plays a key role in giving the individual who don't have power. But this country really likes the individual, and we won't be having the same conversation as Norway, Sweden, and Denmark can be successful. The second problem is distrust in government. I'm not going to talk about that very much because John's going to talk about that a lot. But distrust in government is at an all-time high. People they think more will get done. They can watch it more carefully, and it'll be more representative of them. And people, we do have to deal with this issue of distrust in government, which the right has fed for 30 years, and a universal campaign on message for 30 years does have impact. You're not in favor of the status quo. And you see that playing out presidentially. And look at advertising, right? Tide doesn't market, this is your mother's Tide. They market, this is new and Tide. America, the single biggest word in advertising that is used to market goods is you. The second biggest word is new. So part of our problem is we always make the government conversation sound like the status quo. And I loved it, Jeff, when you said government is the agent of change. Government can be the agent of change. Say that everything is perfect. There was a wonderful anthropological study that was done, and I and many of you have heard me talk about this before, where they asked Germans, Brits, and Americans different things for commercial sloganing, and they asked them, they use the slogan, this beer has been the same formula for 99 years, Bavarian beer, there's no question about it, 99 years the same as the best beer, it's Bavarian beer, it's our beer. The Americans were dumbfounded, they were absolutely silent in the focus groups, and the moderator said, okay, well, what do you think of that? And they go, 99 years and you couldn't improve it, give it to us, we'll make it better in 6 months. And so as we talk about government, we have to talk about what the reform is and what the, how government produces change. And frankly, the other side has been a lot better about that than we. Finally, last point I'll make, how do we fund? That's a real question. And even some of our base is very tax sensitive. Latinos, for example, are very tax sensitive. Blue-collar voters are tax sensitive because they're out of money. If you haven't had a raise in 20 years and cost of living is going up, you're... But there are lots of revenue sources that people support. 66% of Americans support the top 2% paying more. 64% support large corporations paying more. Even when you include increases in your tax, tax candidate, the candidate who is for tax fairness but increasing taxes to spend on things like education and retirement beats the no tax candidate 56-33. And when you juxtapose it against should have the cuts in these programs instead of increasing taxes in that dialogue, even though people would solve every program by putting waste, fraud, and abuse to source the program. The candidate who is against the cuts and for tax increases beats 54-38. And Frank, who is here, and EPI have done a tremendous amount of work on this. So the point is, while people are tax sensitive and we should not take that lightly, there are plenty of ways to address that concern. So on that note, let me turn it over to John to.
Great. Thanks, Linda, and thanks to the authors and EPI. This is my first time. We share offices. We used to share offices with EPI. We miss you guys, but it looks like you've moved up in the world and have nice digs over here. So congratulations. And I encourage you to get the book. It's really well written, and I think it'll be useful for the question when I was invited to this, does the public support something of this nature? And my answer is yes, a potential national majority exists to support much of this agenda, not all of it, with three big caveats. And I'm going to get to that in just a second. If you look at the abstract debate over big government versus it does not work for progressives. I can't find a point at any time in the past 23 years in Gallup Pew polling where the basic question, should the government do more to solve problems versus leave more to individuals or businesses? There's one point in the past we had net positive ratings of government. So really, you know, in the abstract, a bigger versus smaller government debate doesn't work. That said, we've done extensive research on what people would actually, what they want the government looking at this agenda in infrastructure, security, opportunity, shared prosperity, we have large majorities of people across ideological and partisan lines supporting action on jobs, on the environment, on economic security issues. And even more specifically, we have tested, and we did this in context, many of the specific ideas that are listed by Lane and Jeff on page 29, which is a really fantastic list of things that we would be doing with this new agenda. We have very high levels of support for increasing the minimum wage and indexing it to inflation, for paid leave, for paid sick days, for universal sickness insurance program, but I assume there would be support there. Wage insurance, we tested expanding the EITC dramatically, high levels of support there. And we even tested a national jobs program, and we get majority, strong majority support for this. So if you have an abstract debate, you will lose. If you talk about what you're going to do when we act in through our achieve a better society that provides more security, more opportunity, and more prosperity, people could get behind you. Now, what's the problem here? Well, Celinda mentioned the biggest problem is the federal government. People, I mean, I just looked at ratings on, are members of Congress ethical or not? It's it. Members of Congress have high or very high ethical standards. Most people look at the government and they don't see all of these great programs you all are promoting and that, you know, CAP and others support. They see a bunch of rich, out-of-touch politicians, interests, line their pockets. It's really quite bad. Like, the populist sentiment is real. And the federal government, you know, it is responsible for most of this. So in the abstract, people would love the government to do a lot more. Do they trust the government as it exists now to do any of this? No. Sanders' campaign tried to do. If you combine political reform and a more progressive social democratic agenda, I think you have a winning formula. But absent like serious political reform, and it's primarily around money and politics and the outputs of government policy towards special interests, it's going to be very hard to move some of this. People feel they pay the right amount of taxes. They are all for like massive tax increases on the rich, probably ones that exceed even some of the ones that are being proposed by people on the left. But we do see no one is making the case that there needs to be broader tax increases. I've seen no evidence, and there's because there's been no arguments, that we should move towards some kinds of Nordic states would need that. We have to start defending that idea. This is an idea that is split on the left. I'll talk about that in a minute. But people believe the government has plenty of money, and that since it's paying out things to bankers, it's paying out things to rich people, it's not pay more taxes. I want you to fix all this other stuff. The third one that I will mention is we're entering a period globally, particularly in Western democracies, of what is called welfare parochialism, welfare chauvinism. And Lane, your graph on GDP, government expenditures to GDP, has all the Nordic European states. In all of those states, you're getting 10 to 20 nationalist parties around. The Danish People's Party, UKIP, the Finns, the Austrian Freedom Party, the National Front. All of them support the basic social welfare provisions of European nations, but none of them want it to go to anybody but themselves. And so what we're going to get in the future is more economic security, but real concerns about who's getting it. And in Europe, it's about refugees. Here, it's about immigration. There's going to be a big generational divide here, which I want to talk to in a minute. Younger people clearly want more government spending on opportunity measures and economic security issues. The party of the left needs to figure out what the overall relative balance is. This leads to my second point. The politics on this is particularly mixed. I can get you good numbers, and I have lots of them, that show Republican voters and conservatives supporting a variety of things that progressives believe in. As soon as any of their leaders mention big government or put it in an ideological context, we lose them. They go from majority support to majority opposition on something as popular as paid leave and even paid sick days once you introduce ideological information. So strong opposition who really doesn't want to do this. And the problem is that the broad Democratic left progressive, social democratic, mainstream democratic party is not at all united behind this type of agenda. And part of what, consumption tax is one thing we mentioned. There are lots of reasons why people worry about that. We get a lot of promises now to do a lot of the spending you all are proposing and we agree with, without much on the tax side. So basically, we're going to increase taxes on the rich and do all the stuff we want to do, and that's unrealistic. So until the progressive left gets serious about defending the need in terms of GDP terms, no one's going to believe it. This leads to another question here is, what is the relative balance and how is this structured? We see lots of evidence people like state government expanding. If you look at the relative rankings of federal, state, and local government, the federal government gets horrible ratings. State and local government, they get... This has to start by building on our deep blue progressive states, California, Maryland, Massachusetts, places like that, and continue to show that this model of greater social economic provisions and involvement by government can work at the federal level. Because right now, there's too much doubt about the federal level for that to happen. That said, we can expand on the models that are working in the states. The other question I always grapple with is, how should these things be structured? A lot of what we do is very progressive. Now, the things that people like are very universal, particularly the economic security. So, strained revenue period, we want to make it more progressive, but really the only way to get support for this is to make sure everybody gets it. And that's a difficult conversation in some ways. Just briefly, this raises the question of values. I mean, I think there's very strong, where you move it, what do you appeal on? Is it on security? Is it on inequality? Is it on growth? Is it on some perception of the common good? Is it on individual opportunity? These aren't just buzzwords or phrases. These are core things that people would promote. So the best available evidence suggests right now that the easiest way in the near term is to expand economic security measures in a universal manner. That's the evidence I have now. Obviously, you want to move in a variety of other ways. I did mention the generational split. Young people in particular are very concerned about the diminished prospects on social mobility and opportunity. So there will be some intragenerational discussion about how we spend our resources in these areas, which I think is the correct way to go. But in the near term, I think we're likely to have some fights over this. Which leads to my final point, which is we need better, more progressive, social democratic style institutions and media to promote this, because what is outlined and looks pretty there are very few sustained efforts to sort of make this case for how the government can actually do more to improve your life, to improve national prosperity. There are tons of good think tanks and other grassroots organizations, but really, forward, what are we seeking to achieve in terms of the country? How will it be structured, and what will be the cost and benefits to you? In a sustained way for 10 to 20 years, we can make this case, but if we're not thinking in terms of how to sell this ideologically and in a convincing manner based upon people's real needs, it will be difficult to do. So I'll leave it there. And thanks again for the book.
And thank you all very much. It's a little unusual and different that the empiricists and the social scientists are pretty optimistic about the path forward, and then we get the opinion researchers who tell us, yeah, not now. And that's really going to drive the first question. Well, not now in terms of having the public. So I just wanted to ask briefly about those impediments. You know, John, you talked about the public really looking at the federal government, which, quite frankly, is the nexus for a lot of the solutions and path forward that were offered in the book. The incredibly low 8% that you used. But do you have any ideas about how you chip away at that? Is that something that requires its own strategy to deal with, or it's a matter of just getting government functioning at a higher level, or is there something immediate and targeted?
You know, what would be a progressive populist approach on this, which is essentially the Warren Sanders EPI-supported, CAP-supported approach of taking the government back to make it work for average families again. And that's a very powerful idea, which is we actively, as Democrats, that we need to work for us, work better. I think that's part of it. There are the perennial issues about waste management, fraud, things of that nature. Those are real. You know, that stuff is not as compelling as a public message. What they really want to see is, does this entity called the federal government actually care about me? Collection, as we heard in focus groups, of millionaires doing the bidding of billionaires. That's the way the U.S. public views the federal government that we're talking about expanding here. That's a serious challenge. So you need to combine political reform, a challenge to the status quo, with, I think, a more progressive social democratic.
Anybody else want to comment on that?
I would just add one thing, which is I think we would be helped by separating politics and government. When you think about it, the critiques actually are really of politics much more than government. And when you separate out government, which has been done in some of the unionization efforts, et cetera, I mean, people love their firefighters, and they think of them as the anti, I think of. They used to love their police. It's more mixed now. They love their child abuse workers. They love their teachers. So I think one of the things we ought to talk about here, reform, let's not become part of the problem and hit government too. Let's make the distinction between politics and government, and who in their right mind would defend politics right now? I certainly wouldn't. And I work in it every day. So I think that's serving us well as individuals, nor is it serving us collectively well as our government. And we need to change politics.
All right. And Jeff, Lane, John, and Peter, any or all of you, if you want to respond to this whole notion that, you know, part of making the evidentiary case is looking at international comparisons where people are looking a little bit more inward and really focused on taking care of our own, however you define that. And I just want you to just sort of respond to that in terms of making this evidentiary case broadly to a people who seem to be more inward looking.
I'll only take one minute.
I don't like governments more than their federal government. It's probably because they know what state governments are doing for them. Same with local governments. Pretty clear, and it's, I think, it's a hobby horse of some good scholars that people don't know what federal government is doing. So that's one issue. I wish it's more about that. I don't think, frankly, the left or the right candidate is very clear about that. But secondly, we are humbled by this idea that we can't expand government very much. So we have, for me, I know Elizabeth, policies were quite bold, but in fact, there are potpourri of things we've talked about for a long time that she's finally caught up with or willing to talk about publicly. But they're not bold in the sense that she's not going out and saying, this is really going to affect America and change it for the better. And the problem, I think, is then people say, okay, how are you going to pay for it? That becomes hobbling. We have some ideas about how to pay for it. We think we can pay for it. John and Celinda are saying that people don't want to pay for it, but I think that's a rather serious issue. We also think, probably most of us on this panel think, there's room for the federal deficit to expand here. And while we're at it.
Just one very brief point, which is that while a lot of the evidence that is in this book does compare across countries, a good bit of it is historical evidence from the United States, as we are from across countries. The conclusions lean in exactly the same direction, which is as helpful from an analytic point of view. I don't know the extent to which that's helpful in selling it politically. I can't really speak to that.
All right, we'll go to questions from our audience. I could just ask that you be to you. Why don't we start closer to you, Margaret? And then we'll try to move forward as much as we can.
Jim Sang.
I like Peter and Academic John's arguments, but can I ask each of them one question? One, John, you point out that the other things happened is a very powerful argument. Doesn't that apply to your argument, i.e. your 1870 to present includes two-thirds of all the full period? And for countries like Austria and Germany and France, it basically includes the rebuilding from World War II. So aren't those other things that happened? And Peter, I have lots of friends in France. They represent the triumph of the French system. They're plot technicians and Ecole Normales who came from working class families and whose children didn't go to Ecole Normale. But they have their nieces and nephews about the French work job situation, the sclerosis in France. And I wonder if you comment about that, since you talk about how well things are going in Europe.
If we could do the first one, maybe, I think, the dynamics of the French economy at this point. So,
yeah. So
if you want.
Okay. So I'll respond to the first question. And I agree wholeheartedly that other things do matter. Other things are changing over time. And that's the nuance that comes through in the book that I don't have time to do in the 10-minute presentation. You know, the best attempts to control for other things that are going on. And I'm doing that myself. And so there are some econometric studies that find a negative effect of growth in government on economic growth. But you need to do you need to focus on the very recent period after the divergence in size of government across countries. So you start with data from the mid-1970s or later, okay, when pretty much in all these countries, the size of government is just fluctuating around and not growing in any sustained way. Because then all of your evidence is driven by short-term fluctuations, the relationship between like taxes are low at the bottom of a recession and then the economy grows fast. But that's not informative about the question of if we had a government that was 10% larger as a percentage of GDP permanently. Okay, so if you expand the sample to look back to 1960 at least, which is after the Gordon period you're talking about and so forth, you know, econometrically you can't find any long-run equilibrium relationship between the size of government and either growth or the level of GDP. It's extrapolating from little fluctuations to try to figure out what a persistent change of government would do. Much better to look at when government changed a lot and see, did growth change? And when I do that, and also control for many other things, I find essentially no relationship. So that's the best I can do with that.
Just quickly on the French front. France has a mixture of policies, including defective policies that have nothing to do with the size of government or support programs of the welfare state. Their really bad policies are completely separate, and they are just buying off particular interests. They had the 35-hour week, which is a terrible idea for them to get into in a world that doesn't do that. And then they had, like so many Mediterraneans and Latin Americans, they have these employee protection laws that are hard for young people to get hired because the senior, typically male, workers are so protected by those laws. None of that relates to welfare state and the basic.
I just have to comment, maybe because it's very important to me, about the Bob Gordon great invention period. This is a highly simplified view of why economies, not least because it financed the development of the railroads. The rapid productive use of transportation in that period allowed for the expansion of mass economies of scale production. That's just one example. Then there was literacy. That is a sadly, forgive me for my strong language because I think it's very misleading, but it's a sadly simple view of why economies grow. Suddenly, there's a spurt of rapid inventions. In fact, last point, European economic historians, correct me if I'm and not in the 1800s in Britain, but in the 11 and 1200s in Flanders, when there was a great deal of prosperity due to textile technologies, but also the advances in transportation and a bunch of other issues. With a grain of salt, even too.
We're going to go to the front here. This gentleman.
Judd Harriet. I had a question for Celinda, but she is split, so I'm going to dump on John here.
Quickly, if you
mentioned that the demographics were propelling our society towards a role for government position. Do you agree with that? And if you do, do we have a political system and a core of politicians who can capitalize on that and move us towards a more progressive society?
Demographics in the country, and most of what is commonly known as President Obama's coalition, the rising number of young people, millennials, communities of color, particularly, and rising professional groups and things of that nature, they raise about government. So if you look at this over time and how the electorate's going to shift, the people who are most vehemently anti-government are shrinking as a share of the electorate, and the people who at this moment are ideologically more open to government are growing. Now, that leaves a huge hole. Like, yeah, we should have national health care or higher spending on tuition-free college. They have tons of questions about the structure of government, who it works for, things of that nature. So the demographics alone are just trends you can look at. People who are capitalizing on these attitudes and being responsive enough to fix the system to do what this group of people actually wants. It's getting better, but it's not there yet. That's how I would answer it. So the shift in population, it has to be built in some kind of way. And it, more likely than not, it happens in a steady, non-ideological way where specific problems are dealt with on a state-by-state level and then something's done at the federal level. You know, we don't come soon unless we change the electoral system of the country. So what you'll get, I think, is a steady accretion of people supporting things that expand government in ways that are actually beneficial for their own security and opportunity.
Can I just say really quickly, I think that's essentially how it happened in most of the Northern Europe. Labor Social Democratic Party set out a platform that said, let's go up by 10 percentage points of GDP. It was policy by policy, incrementally, and you look after a generation, and all of a sudden, you've got more social programs and a bigger state as well.
Okay, we have time, unfortunately, for one final question, and it's going to be you.
Yeah, thanks for your presentation. But if I think about a title, how big should the government, I'm looking at what's the weakness of our system, but I didn't hear sort of missing. I just wonder if you can address anywhere, they can tell you, today we have a nominee from parties, their approval rating just so low, it's meaningless to say that they are our leaders, and you even mentioned that the commander-in-chief worldwide. So I just wonder, by definition, you know, the Republican and Democrat, they are thinking about regulation or non-regulation. It's sort of different concept. It's totally different. And there are data that I think, whether you are economic or sociology, or you are educational experts, I think they are using the data, existing data, people created for them. There's no way to verify them, whether they are right or wrong.
Now we've given us enough to chew on, because I think we want to address, this is a great question to end on, because it addresses how we got here. And go ahead, Peter.
Yeah, I wanted to address the question. Go ahead with the final sentence to make sure I know the full.
The concept, for instance, if the the Salina Lake, they have survey data, but they don't really have expansion that people can answer. All the data, question 1, 2, 3, 4, is meaningless.
Okay.
The comment section and, is maybe more important.
And agreeing with what I think is the spirit of public opinion question asked about government or federal government. Fortunately, they don't use the word Washington, it would be even worse. But government or federal government, since the year 2009, watch out. You should only be interested in the questions that unpack who you're talking about, of the government, etc. And very few of them ever unpack Congress from the executive, etc. Since 2009, it has been an act, and now within Congress, it has been an active strategy, never deviated from, of the Republican Party that might make the executive branch look good. Since 2009, since Obama came into office, they had a meeting about it. It was in the news at the time, and they've stuck by that plan. So watch out between Congress and executive. Here's a good quick clue about this, close to the our issue of big government. Notice wrong direction, and things in government are heading in the wrong direction. That'll get like 65% negative feelings, okay? Who is our president? He has a 58% approval rating, or 54 sometimes only. But the public is actually able to make some of this distinction if blocked than just federal government.
Jeff, if you could just address this whole concept you alluded to in your beginning. You know, you can point to the Reagan Revolution as a seminal moment, but in fact, going before then, you know, Reagan explains a response to the 70s and the perceptions of, how do you opine about the sustained effective assault on government that has been maintained during periods of economic growth and vitality and expansion and popular presidents? What are your thoughts about how this has continued to sort of have an impact?
I'm sure my co-authors have a view on this, but let's begin with the premise of rapid economic growth and prosperity. It didn't really work for the last generation or so. We've had stagnation. The early Reagan years, in fact, one of the hallmarks of Alan Greenspan's tenure as chairman has been rising inequality and stagnating wages. I just read a biography of Greenspan. The word inequality appears in a 675-page biography, appears three times. So people have suppressed that idea. I think as I read history, people tend to be more willing to pay taxes and be more progressive about the uses of government when they're better off. I recognize the Great Depression seems like an anomaly there. So I think, I sometimes think I'm too, a lot of bitterness, people are not doing well, that you don't want to pay more taxes when you're not doing well. You need that money for other things. So I think that's the underlying issue. I want us to grow faster through fiscal over this period of rising inequality. And I could go on a little bit, but maybe some other people want to contribute.
Terrific. Anyone else? Well, on that, thank you all very much. This was an incredibly impressive conversation. Like I said, we do have purchase them, and as long as their schedules allow, maybe you can get an unanswered question into the authors. Thank you.